Good morning, Lee Heights Church.
Good morning.
We have a little change this morning because your brother here has been so very tired. I don't have an announcement video made. And so we're going to go throw back to the old school like we had a Kirk. And if you would just open up your bulletins and turn to the back, we can go through our announcements. For those of you who are watching us live on YouTube or Facebook, this is the way Lee Heights used to do it before there was video. I need your prayers. I get with y'all, and I'm going through so much. But I do the best I can. To the youth out there, we need your help. We need you to pick up some batons. Come on and find out what makes the church service work. And twice a month, you have junior church downstairs so that you can go and practice what it's like to invite people to come and worship and get in touch with God. So our bulletins on the back, we're going to get a thank you from the Howard family for your cards and the repass and the service on the loss of Pam's brother, Elmore Howard III. May have said that wrong. You know Craig Berkey and Rosie Berkey. Craig lost his mom. His mom transitioned during the same time. So we're going to send prayers to the Berkey families spread out on the passing of their matriarch, Cecilia Berkey. Today we'll have junior church. During our worship service, we want to have the kids have some space for them so they don't feel pressured to be like us, because God's doing a new thing. Our budget meeting for Lee Heights Community Church is coming up on April 28th in 2 weeks. If you are a department head, it's encouraged that you be there, because if you need some things for your budgets for us to plan, we need to know what your needs are. It's coming up on Mother's Day next month. Of course, the men are going to cook breakfast for the women, because that's what we do. We take care of our women. And I will be like Al and say, men, we need you to show up so that you can come and prepare a breakfast. Please see him if you want to volunteer. And finally, on our bulletin, there's a new committee formed called the LGBTQ Learning Committee. This committee is put together by some of our members because there are still people living in the margins of society, and we want to invite them and bring them into our space so that God can help them also. So in order to do that, we have to find a way to understand how to do what Jesus did. Because Jesus went to the margins. He went to those who were outcasts and spent time with them. And that's what we do at this church. Anybody's welcome to come to this church. So we thank you. And that would be our bulletin. What we used to do afterwards is ask, were there anything from the floor that didn't get put in the day's bulletin? And I thank you for your patience and your time. Let us open our service with a prayer of invocation. Father God, you love us so much. And in this world that looked like it's about to lose its mind, we know that you are putting things together for your glory, and we're grateful to be of service to you. So we ask you to join us Quiet our minds, still our hearts. Leave the world outside for a moment as we center ourselves in your spirit and we come to hear and learn what it is that I'm to do next, what it is that you need next. And we thank you with all the glory and honor and love in our hearts that goes out to you in Jesus' name. Our call to worship on the theme of life support. We need life support. It's going to come from the book of 1 Chronicles, chapter 16. It's going to be verses 8 through 12. And I wanted to make this kind of a responsive reading. So I will read 8 and 10, and I want you to read 9 and 11, and we can say 12 all together. Give praise to the Lord. Proclaim his name. Make known among the nations what he has done. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice.
Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always.
And together we say, remember the wonders he has done, his miracles, and the judgments he pronounced. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and doing of his word. It's time for our intercessory prayer. This is where we pray for the needs of others. And if you've been watching what's going on TV, you know that they're trying to drum up and start wars. And we choose not to fight those kind of battles. The battles we fight are spiritual ones. And so let us take the time to heal and intercede for those spirits. My dad is coming toward the end of his life. And it's hard to love someone and watch them leave. But you love them while you got them. Some folks don't have their parents. I have both. They've been together 70 years. 70 years. And he still is a fighter. He still is strong. He still is opinionated. And that's the way that we are. So let's go to the throne of grace. Father God, you ask us to check on our elders. You asked us to know our neighbors. Let us make safe space for the children. We need protection. We need to build community. We need to go back to where we were, to what brought us here to this church. The sense of community, the sense of family, the sense of caring. I don't have to like everything that you do, and I don't have to agree with every way that you go through a process, but I do know how to respect you. I know how to show you grace and dignity. I know how to listen and let you get things out. I do not have to be the winner. I do not have to have the last word with my neighbor. I do not have to fix anyone. That is God's domain. God, please come help them. Help them. If I help my neighbor, then I'm helping myself. We had communities where there was no need for policing. There was no need for, what was the first commandment? Do not covet. Do not worry about what someone else is given, because God got a gift for you. He's got a present for you. Let us continue to be good neighbors. Let us continue to be the one who shows and represents the God that I serve, that died on a cross just so that you have a chance to have a second chance. Help stop the wars. Stop killing God's creations. Help bring about healing, because that's what we need. We pray for our leaders, that they just take a step back and quit worrying about what someone else says and look to the Spirit. How does it make you feel? How does it make you feel? We'll give God all the honor and glory and praise that is due, because His love is beyond anything that I could ever imagine. I've never, never lived a life as good as I have when I accepted the Lord into my life. And I thank you. I thank you for community. I thank you for the gift of church, the gift of family, and the gift of friends. Because it's the people that make the difference. Buildings come and go. You can destroy them. We can build another. But the people make the difference. Did you know that you are the representation of your whole lineage? That if you look into my face, you see my face, my father and mother's, my grandparents, my great-grandparents, my great-great-grandparents. You see my family when you see me. So when you cross paths with another spirit, remember, you're looking at their history, who they are. Thank you, Lord. It's in Jesus' name that we say this prayer. Amen. And now we're going to turn over to our ministry of music as we get prepared for our word today.
Congregational corporate hymn. Our hymn for the day is "I Surrender All." As Greg said, we sometimes just have to press through, and sometimes it's a season of pressing through. And where two or three are gathered in His name, He is in the midst, and we thank Him for that time and opportunity to praise Him. Would you stand and join with us as we sing? For those in the hymn book, it is 373. If you'd like to follow the hymn, we'll sing the first two verses.
Just one. heart. We just want to worship him as we sing praises, what we do, and as we always, I surrender all. And in this season of pressing through, just praise is what I do in everything that I go through. We have to praise him.
Close to you.
now time for our junior church dismissal. Let us pray. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we are just so grateful for this time that we have here today. We're grateful, Father, that you have brought us to this place, but also, Father, how you have kept us on this week. Some of us have experienced some life changes this week. Some of us have faced some life realities this week. But Father, we just thank you in the midst of it all that you have kept us close to you, that you've given us a pause to look on the other side of what is taking place and be thankful that we have a God who is with us in any season of our life. We're thankful that you have been able to hold us up when we felt like we were falling down. We thank you, Father, because we have embraced and probably gone into some areas of our life where we feel the most high. We thank you. But Father, we come this morning seeking a word so that we will be fueled up for this coming week. And Father, I believe that you have a word for your people today. So Father, we ask that you allow the hearts and minds of your people right now to be open. And Father, we invite you in that you prick those places that we have protected with so much fervor. Now, Father, take this servant of yours who have meditated on the words that you have given her. Move her out, but let what you have given her be used to magnify your word. For Father, then let us all go back out into the world, crossing back over into the threshold, taking the good news that can be captured in our hearts and to taking them back into the world so that someone else will be able to feel your spirit. For Father, we thank thee. And in your name we say amen. We say amen again, and we give you a hand praise of amen this morning. I believe God has a word for us that comes this morning out of the book of Hebrews, once again. Chapter 13, verses 1 through 8, a familiar passage. There's some words in there that I want you to pay close attention to, and the first two are one of those passages. Verse 13. Keep on living. Keep on loving one another as brothers and sisters. Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. Continue to remember those in prison as if you were together with them in prison, and those who are mistreated as if you yourselves are suffering. Verse 5, keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, and I will not be afraid. What can mere mortals do to me? Verse 7. Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of the way of your life and imitate their faith. Verse 8, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Pay close attention to the words, keep on, do not forget, continue to remember, keep your lives free. Never will I leave you, nor will I forsake you. Remember the leaders who spoke the word of God to you. And underline, consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. And with a good highlighter, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. May the Lord add a blessing to the hearing of his holy word. This morning I want to continue on in our sermon series called Life Support. But the word from God entitled, Back in the Day. As I was talking to one of my coworkers this past week, I had a chuckle because we were talking about a documentary that has been out, that came out this past week or two weeks, I believe, on Hulu. We were talking about the documentary that focused on a well-known event that took place in the 80s and the 90s. Known if you were a young person in those eras and very familiar with the term of Freaknik. The event Freaknik and the experience of Freaknik. Now, sounds like some of you don't know what I'm talking about, so let me just keep going. If you know that there are some here, this announcement that came out from the Associated Press goes like this, that if you ever experienced Atlanta's wildest gathering called Freaknik back in the day, then be aware that you might be featured in Hulu's new documentary about the legendary street party and became popular through folklores involving gridlock traffic and just high levels of debauchery. Many of those images were certainly on display in this documentary called Freaknik, the Wildest Party Never Told. But the documentary isn't just on this hyper environmental party that created such public self-safety concerns. It also is about how this party started off as a simple black college cookout that then ended up drawing thousands from around the United States, defining Atlanta as the cultural and music hotbed. You see, I was a part of that generation that celebrated our culture by participating in parties and festive activities such as this and other ones known as the Greek Picnic in Philadelphia, filled with good times and memories. This whole experience of watching the documentary helped me to recapture a statement that many of us can make if you were over 30 years old. You start thinking about what you did in your heyday. You know, it's that time in your life when you think about what was it when I was doing in my heyday, in my heyday. Oh, I can't even talk about some of those things, you might say. But this is a time when you felt like you were the most free and you had the most fun. This time for me, a lot of times in my heyday, is when I was working here at the church day camp, along with what else was going on in Atlanta, and building lifelong relationships with my childhood church friends, such as Sanj and Monday and Chris Ramsby. But here's where we also wanna talk about in our heyday is when you start to reminisce about what took place. You start to reflect about what you were wearing. You started to talk about how you were this size and that size and what you did and for fun. And you start to live in emotions that were once sung by old Frankie Beverly when he says, happy feelings in the air. I'm a believer that you can even have a spiritual heyday, a place where your faith walk is where you felt that you were at your highest point, a place where you felt as if you had hit a pinnacle in your spiritual walk. And maybe you find that place being where you had your baptism, where you joined a church, where it was when you first had a true encounter with God. Maybe it was a time when you realized that you had hit a place where you had turned around and it was time for some repentance to take place, or you just remember what redemption means, or you even started to understand what it meant for Jesus Christ to be resurrected. When you reminisce, you find yourself living in the words from the rap artist Amon when he makes these simple statements that back in the day when I was young, I'm not a kid anymore. But some days I sit and wish I was a kid again. Back in the day when I was young, I'm not a kid anymore. But some days I sit and wish that I was that kid again. Back in the day. I can't sing the rest of those lyrics of that song, you know. But for some, the acknowledgement of the heyday and the reality of nostalgia can cause us to have a bit of a spiritual toggle going on in our spiritual walk. You see, nostalgia represents a past that is associated with a very sense of a level of normalcy. When I started working as an associate pastor here at Lee Heights, I remember being approached by Pastor Robin that one of the assignments for me to do was to provide a structured format for creating the five-year plan. Prior to that, I did not have much of a recollection of how that plan was developed, but I know that he came to me and he said, I would like for you to create a structure by which we would do this. I had not too long finished my master's degree at Case Western in organizational behavior, and therefore I had a few fresh techniques and templates that I thought I could use or could orchestrate in order to create a thought process here that will help us move into the future. One such technique that I used was that call of the future search. You see, a future search brings people from all walks of life and you bring them into the same conversations, thinking about what their resources were, thinking about what the expertise is, and also the formal authority. People tell stories about their past, their present, and their desired future. And through dialogue, they discover this common ground. Well, what typically happens is we look at who's able to remember what happened in certain decades, what the church looked like, what your personal life looked like, and also what the world was looking like at that time. We do the same for what is going on presently in the church, what the church looks like now, what your person looks like now, and what is going on in the world. And we try to find a common ground. Now catch this, the presence of the pandemic is a major one that collectively we can either see as a heyday or you can see as some level of nostalgia. Because some people loved the pandemic, I'm telling you. There were some people who wished we could go back there. And then there were some who hated it. Who hated every ounce of it. But we can also note that the presence and the existence of COVID-19, along with the pandemic that began in 2020, caused a shift in the church personally and what takes place in the world, and also created a new normal. There's been some arguments and some discussion about the fact that when people start to worry about what's going on with the church today, that those problems existed prior to March 19, 2020. I don't see I got an amen on that one. But I'm here to tell you that some of them same problems that existed then still are existing now. We started talking about then why folks not coming to church. We started talking about then what the Sunday school looks like. We started talking about then how are we getting the younger people back here. Those were the same conversations we're having now that we had prior to March 19, 2020. But one thing that has reminded me and has always been the same is that if you look into the book of Hebrews, and that is where we find this familiar saying that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. You see, Hebrews, this passage in particular, provides an outlook on the divinity of Jesus Christ from a very comprehensive perspective. And yet we embrace the entirety of who Jesus Christ is at every single point in our life. He is the same. He's the same when I was 20. He's the same when I was 30. He's the same when I was 40. And he gonna be the same when I turn 55 on Wednesday. He's the same one. And although our lives have opened up numerous chapters and turned pages and they've experienced some commas, some colons, some semicolons, Jesus Christ has remained the same. And although we find ourselves walking through and saying, like, why do I got to have these changes in my journey, these stumbles in my walk? We know, too, that Jesus Christ has made us sojourners on this way and crusaders in another way. But Jesus Christ has always been there. And through it all, Christ has never faltered. He's never failed to serve as the ultimate carrier of grace, truth, mercy, and love for the sake of our own survival and eternally our salvation. This passage reminds us that we serve a Savior that is the same. The very one who was crucified for our sins can cause a resurrection that will make you change your ways and affect the way you live. That in and of itself is enough life support. You see, beloved, we find that serving the same God who loved you through the messiness will make you immovable because you will see and have benefited from his great works. And because of that, you know you ain't going nowhere. Yesterday and today will show us how the presence of Jesus Christ helps me to hold it together. And even when we have no vision, no hope, and no faith. Yesterday and today will show us how the presence of Jesus Christ made a way when there was no way. Yesterday and today will show us how the presence of Christ affirmed how good God has been to me by traveling with me in all of my valleys, helping me to understand every rock that I have had to stumble over and every bad decision, the even till that I have made and you have made, and every sin that we went back, repented for, and went back again and did it all over again. Yesterday and today will show us how the presence of Christ has provided grace that let me know that he loves me. That he loves me so much that he sent his son, that God sent his son to the cross. But yesterday and today will show us how the presence of Jesus Christ is still here. He lives in today. He lives in yesterday, and he lives for tomorrow. But we must be careful about what can take place if we put too much emphasis, though, on nostalgia. Nostalgia has an effect on moving forward. It has that effect on us moving forward. In the magazine, Christianity Magazine, a writer by the name of Jeremy Sabella writes that in small doses, nostalgia can replenish us who hasn't felt refreshed after reminiscing with old friends. But uncontrolled nostalgia causes us to cling to the golden calf that reminds us of the past rather than recognize the pillars of the cloud and the fire that's guiding us through this present that we're in right now that you still have no uncertain, that you still don't know what it's about. He goes on to say that as the psalmist in Psalm 135 reminds us about our idols, that they have mouths but they cannot speak, eyes but cannot see. They have ears but cannot hear, nor is there breath in their air, in their mouths. For this passage closes with a warning. Those who make them will be like them, and so will all who trust them. Remember Lot's wife, who was transformed into a pillar of salt because she looked back. She became fixed in time as an imagined past she had longed for. For spiritually speaking, we risk the same fate when we idolize the past. The writer asked the question, how do we keep nostalgia from spiritually paralyzing us? The first thing that we must do is you must start with being honest with yourself. Whatever you have told yourself that normal life was in 2020, It wasn't normal. It was abnormal, and it was messed up. But guess what? It's still not here anymore. It no longer exists anymore. It ended, though, with an epidemic. When it became the pandemic, is when we still started to realize that folks, black folks, were still getting killed, breathing their last breath. Remember Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, George Floyd? No economic miracle, no executive order could bring back those human lives, our sense of safety, and our rhythm and our routines. Facing this reality, though, can also stir up grief. And as there are some who say, I want to live in the nostalgia of yesterday, bring back all of what has taken, what we had here at Lee Heights, even what we had in this world, we are really at a different place than we were in 2020. Some of you say, no, we're not, Pastor. Well, then this message is for you today. We really are in a different place. But we should allow this space that we're in and realize sometimes we're at a collective loss. For when we live in the past, we limit the encounters that we're going to have with Jesus Christ and with God. Because let me tell you something. While some people wanted the pandemic to come back, some people got into a reality of realizing who God truly was. You started to understand a little bit more what Psalm 91 meant. You started to realize the impact that Psalm 23 took on your lives. You started to understand the value of relationships. And because each encounter with him allows us to grow and to mature in a way that is far different than how the world sees it. But nostalgia is the enemy of the faith. By lamenting on the good old days, nostalgia tempts us to forsake the present day. Don't miss the encounters with God, because you want to stay in the past. For the narrative may change, but the Spirit of God is always going to be the same. But thankfully, Jesus Christ, again, is what? The same yesterday, today, and forever. He worked through the flawed men like Abraham and Elijah, Peter and Paul. And he still works through us today as flawed people in recent history. Think about this. That in since my heyday, I told you mine was in the 80s and the 90s. We didn't have cell phones back then. All we had was little beepers. And if you had a beeper, that meant that you was doing some other stuff that you really ain't had no business doing. Since my heyday, there have been things that have entered our society that makes people wonder, should they have done in the first place? Should they have come? You were happy to receive the cell phone. You were happy to receive social media, Instagram, MySpace, Snapchat, all the rest of that other stuff. I could keep on going. We're happy to receive that because there are ways in which to embrace people. Can I tell you something? That's the heyday for young people today. They don't remember not having a cell phone. They don't remember not being able to catfish somebody. That's a whole nother piece. Some of you don't know what catfish is. Go look it up. But it ain't the fish. But I want to tell a story, a recent story on the news station that was a human interest story about a man and a woman who had been dating years ago when they were younger. And they probably were in their late teens or in their early 20s. But during this time where they were dating, they found themselves at a point in history where they were not permitted to date. You see, the woman was a Caucasian woman and the man was an African-American man. It was a time when the races could not come together. But because of we know who Jesus Christ is, we know who God is, God was always in the story and in this equation. The woman was told by her parents that she couldn't interact with this young man. And if she did, that there was going to be some repercussions for her. So because she couldn't interact with him or even be associated with him, they decided to break up the relationship. You see, as these two young people then went about their way, navigating through life in the safest way that they possibly could, according to the world, they're still brokenhearted by this love that they thought had been lost. And as the interview goes on, she reflects about how she felt at that time when she felt so alive. She felt so in love and so uplifted by this man. She felt so much at a point where she felt that this was the place to be. And yet 40 and 50 years later, now this woman is a widow. She's had her children. She's gone on with her life. She reflects upon that heyday experience. She starts to look for the man. And guess where she finds him? She finds him in a nursing home. And she also finds him at a place in his life where more hardships have taken over his life than anything else. He was homeless. She began to visit him. They began to rekindle a spirit, a love that never left. This time, even in times where circumstances were different though, the world is different. The people in their lives are different. And even some of the props in the area are different. Now they add a hospital room, a hospital bed, some nurses, and some doctors. But the spirit of God's love is still there. The woman took the man out of the nursing home and took him to live with her in her home, a home that she didn't have back there in her heyday, a place that she had not built up with her husband, who's now deceased. She took him back to her house. And eventually they got married. Why? Because the spirit, the love of God was still there. Her heyday was still in place. It just had some different surroundings. See, I personally struggle sometimes with the statement that if we could go back, because there are things that I have discovered on this faith walk that I wish I knew then. There's some stuff, reason I really don't want to go back to some things, because if I can't go back, I remember when my mother had passed and somebody said, do you ever wish she was back here? I said, this is God's plan. And I said, I don't want her to come back the way she had to leave here. I would rather her be back the way she was when I was in my 30s and she was in her 60s. But what has God, has God's love left me? No. Has God surrounded me all that time? Yes. He was the same one who was loving on me. When I had to, in March of 2013, and got a phone call that says that now your life is changing. Your life has changed forever. It's the same God now who still can remind me of those good memories. I wish I just had known sometimes what I knew, what I wish I had known now, what I knew then, that God still's there for me. But real talk, for some nostalgia creeps in as a heyday because you remember when things look like this. Yes, I'm gonna tell you, and be honest with you, I've heard more people talk about what the church looked like in the heyday. The heyday for some was what it looked like in the lobby, what it looked like out here, how it felt, and so forth and so on, and things like that. But can I tell you, though, that heyday was only personal, because for some people, that heyday was a hell day. What was going on? My experience here at Lee Heights, I have been here because God has called me here, and I know God is right next to me. But in somebody's heyday here at Lee Heights, that was not always the best day for me. Dealing with some of the things, the struggles of coming in, transitioning. This real talk. Transitioning into this role. Transitioning as a woman. It has not always been happy feelings in the air. It's not. But I knew one thing. God never left me. God never left me. And I've been able to experience God through many of you, as in how you have navigated through a new heyday. We have the nostalgia here. That also can bring about the fact of why God put us here at 4612 Lee Road. Because remember this, back in the day, God said these words, Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And he still says it today. Back in the day, God said in Jeremiah 29:11, "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." And he still says that today. Back in the day, in Philippians 4:7, it says, "And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." And he still says that today. And back in the day, in Proverbs 3:5, it says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not onto your own understanding." And he still says that today. For us, it's time to make a shift. It's time to make a shift. There's an article that says why so many Americans have stopped going to church. In the past 25 years, over 40 million Americans have stopped going to church. Yes, you heard me right. 40 million. That's about 12% of the population. What people need to hear today in this news story is that there is something that's going on, and it's called, and it's not so much in the Bible. It's one that's being worked out now in this. It's the parable of the growing church. There's a story about how the Christian community might better serve its members if we just look into the mirror and understand the Christian identity and the transcendence and the community as we move today. When we look even at the parables of Jesus Christ, it reveals the kingdom of God. And as we do this now, we shift in that manner. And so let me navigate with you just a little bit for this one, because you all, everybody in here is going to remember it, except for little Malachi. This news report, because he's in his heyday now. This is old news. It's fossil news that I'm getting ready to tell you. A news report in 2016 reflects the airport security prior to 9/11/2001. Anybody remember airport security prior to 9/11? You do, right? Yeah. 15 years ago, this is a report that came out in 16. It talks about when those terrorists hijacked the airlines and flew into the World Trade Center, the Pentagon, killing nearly 3,000 people, and the national security efforts changed forever. For many Americans, nowhere are their policies more apparent than at the airport. Here's a reminder of what used to be when you used to go to the airport. There were private communities and not the government who oversaw the screening. You could bring just about anything into the airport. You could drink your water as you was walking through. You could have your food on you as you were walking through. You could act a fool up in the airport and nobody said anything to you. You didn't have to worry about being on a list or even being put on a terrorist list because you refused to give up your seat. The entire industry, from airport security to flight attendant training to even the airlines in existence, was reshaped because of the deadliest terrorist act in the U.S. history. And even if you went to the Greyhound, it changed. When did you have to go through security to get on the Greyhound bus? You do now. The encounter with 9/11 was toxic enough. But here's something else we also need to know, that this encounter made us look at how we now look at one another more specifically. But from a spiritual perspective, we could encounter this the same way as which we hadn't encountered any other situation in our lives. It helps us to realize that the Spirit of God and the Holy Spirit doesn't just live within the walls of the church, but it also tells us how we look at people. Change is going to happen, and change is happening every day. As followers of Christ, we are told to change. For Jesus said, we must become like little children. A child is trusting, and so we must trust God no matter our changing situations, no matter how much. If spiritual growth means happening, it has to refer to nothing more. Maybe look at some best practices. But as we continue our walk in Christ, We will live by the Spirit and not by what occupies the theatrical set by which we live in and all the props that are surrounding us. The crucifixion of Jesus Christ along with the resurrection went before us to show us the footprints that will lay in front of us as we travel in this journey called life. In essence, Jesus left the past, and Jesus left what was deemed as comfortable, normal, and livable. And Jesus left what was the most familiar and traveled to the cross in order so that we might move forward. So get out of the rut of yesterday. So as I get ready to take my seat, beloved, when we live in our heyday, we hinder ourselves from moving forward. When we live in our heyday, we have a tendency to disconnect ourselves from how God was with us and still is very much with us now. When we live in our heyday, we go back. We go back to when we try to capture what's there and we fight to get it moved to this place. Never experienced somebody who tried to move something back into this space? I had a friend, one of my mother's friends. I won't say his name. We always knew when he was coming and had the biggest smile on his face. His clothing stayed in 1970. He had still wear the big bell bottoms and the polyester shirts and everything like that. Still wore them and rocked the afro like it wasn't nothing. He rocked it in the 80s, he rocked it in the 90s, he rocked it in the 2000s, and when I see him now, he's still rocking it. But some of us like to live our life that way, that we fight to move. And sometimes we gotta move in that space. So ask yourself this, is God moving, but I'm just not willing to move? God reminds us in Ecclesiastes 7:10, do not say, why were the good old days better than these? For it is not wise to ask such questions. It's not wise because looking back in regret chokes out the life of our days, which are finite. Once each minute passed on the clock is gone forever, never to be recovered. It's not wise because it steals our joy. It's not wise because it hinders your service to Jesus Christ. And it's not wise because it's not the truth. And every moment of every day is a mixture of good and bad blessings and things that wound. So, beloved, I ask you this question. Can your heyday be every day? Live like your day. Live like today is your heyday. Are we looking back and believing that the former days were better than the worst? What are you regretting? What have you lost? What do you grieve? Are you wishing God would resurrect something he was doing in your life, but you know now it's dead? You see, I want to encourage you today to join him in his new work. Join him in the present. That's where he wants to bless you. But what are you waiting for? Let the morning, as it tells us in Psalm 143, let the morning bring me word of your unfailing love, for I put my trust in you. For when we move out of the past, we begin to trust in what God has in store for us. Show me the way that I will go, for to you I entrust my life. When we move into today and move into tomorrow, we'll start to see. When we look into the tomb, we'll start to see it differently. Live like today is your heyday. Stop putting conditions on how you see God blessing you and how you experiencing God in its fullest. How many of us know somebody who wants to put conditions, want to tell God how to bless them? All right. Stop blocking the blessings. Stop giving excuses, especially since God didn't give you any excuses when he was with you and so-called in your heyday. Yesterday. Live like today is your heyday. Open your eyes and see the various ways in which God has stood by you in the various times in your life. Live like today is your heyday and give your heyday an opportunity to transfer the experience. letting the circumstances, the situation, the happy feelings, and the props of your heyday become whispers that don't allow you to live in today. Don't let those whispers stop you from experiencing the growth of your spirit. Don't let the whispers from your heyday stop the encounters, and don't let them stop you from learning from the circumstances of the day and the props that have been given and put in your way. There's still so much that we can live and learn in this day. It doesn't just take the fact that the choir stands are up here to make you live in this heyday. It doesn't just take the fact that you have a bulletin board out there in the fellowship or in the vestibule in order for you to live in your heyday. Stop blocking God for what he has for you to do. Because let me tell you something. Even though Jesus is unchanging, his unchanging nature still means that he's here with us. He ain't go nowhere. Maybe you've shifted, but he didn't go nowhere. Amen. He's the Son of God who has been the same even through the changes that the world was taking him through. He didn't go nowhere. He's been the same one who's been with you. I told someone, when I have colored my hair, there's one color blonde, one color brunette, one color black. He's been there. Even now with the gray that's coming in, he's still been there. Live like today is your heyday. For we need to think about all of this and understand that Jesus Christ is no different today than when he was on this earth. Jesus Christ is the same one who stood with those who were in this choir stand and said and sang out songs that billowed out into the world. And he's the same one who stands with the team today and they bellow out his message. He's the same teacher. He's the same encourager. He's the same motivator. He's the same healer. He's the same Savior. And he's the same Lord who was here 50 years ago, 20 years ago, last night, and still today. He has the same power to change us so that we tell the story about the miraculous God in which we serve. He is, because Jesus Christ wants to heal us, spiritual and physically. He's the one who makes the spiritual blind see and the lame walk. He is here with us today. He's the same. He's the same. And so it's now time for us. Stop putting excuses. Stop blocking the blessing. Start trusting in God. Let us pray. Gracious and Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your reminder today. Thank you, Father, that you have came and been here with us all throughout the years and before we were even here. You have blessed us. And so, Father, we just ask right now today that you continue to take those cataracts off of our hearts so that we can still live in your presence, the presence of your spirit. Father, we don't look down upon what has carried us through and how that heyday has probably given us the support we need. But Father, please let us not rest in it to a point that it draws us to a point of grief and to a point of negative thoughts. But let us use it, Father, as maybe something we want to run after, those times where I felt like I was so most alive with who you were. And I want to get back to that point. Help me to use it in that way today, God. Father, we ask with the hearts open and minds just ready to be soaked by your spirit. Father, we thank you for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, For had he stayed in his heyday, there would be no resurrecting power for us today. Had he stayed in his heyday, had we not had an opportunity to understand what it means to be in full reconciliation with you, forgiveness of our sins, and eternal life. So, Father, we thank you and thank you and thank you for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Speak to the hearts of your people. Speak to the minds of those who thirst for you. For, Father, we thank thee, and in your name we say amen, amen, and amen. At this time, we want to invite all of those this morning, if you are feeling called to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. You say it's time right now. It's time right now where I need to make that step and get out of my heyday of that I'm in that doesn't show you walking, it doesn't show my acceptance of you. We also want to invite those this morning, if you are feeling called to it, to join this church at this time. You say, I need somewhere to go. I need somewhere else to grow. We invite you to come. And those who are also in need of prayer this morning, we invite you to come at this time.
Thank you.
done something for you in a special way. Was not an accident. He made you for this moment. You are living your purpose. What's in your mind, what's in your heart, is not an accident. Your problems to the Lord in prayer. You can stand, you can touch and agree. We're going to have an altar call of sorts. Back in the day is today. Today is back in the day. We take those moments from our past and we bring them into right now, because this is how we fight our battles. This is how we do what God wants us to do. And there was an African saying for that. I want you to remember the word Sankofa. Sankofa. There's a movie worth watching called Sankofa. Sankofa was a bird, and this bird is facing forward. But that bird stretches its neck to the past to grab the seed, the egg, the point of learning, and bring it to the forward, so that you can plan your future by looking at your past. But you have to stand in the present. This is how I fight my battles. Read a book. Read the word. Get some education. Love your neighbor. Father God, your servants are here for you, Lord. They need some clarity on what direction to go. Teach them to trust you, to trust that Spirit. If you do something new every day, then I'm not supposed to be stuck in yesterday. I have to be prepared for today. And that gives me hope. My grandson needs a place to be himself. Our children need to learn that they were created for a purpose. I don't have to control them. They are little short people. They already got their minds and their assignment. Just have to help them. So I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward, because one of the ways that we help our children and our youth is by our gifts, by them seeing our generosity, by them seeing what we give, how freely we give. We give from what God gives us. I still believe I'm living on God's checkbook. Every blessing comes with a financial responsibility. It may look like without fight. God will take care of it. I promise.
That you pay attention and continue to pray for those who are on our prayer list this morning. Also continue to pray for our young people who are downstairs today for junior church. And all of the announcements that are here. Continue to pray for our families who are experiencing levels of grief and our bereavement. As well. Let us stand for the sending forth. Shows you, you get to a point, you had something in your mind. And I can't even grab at what it was I wanted to say. It was something I was about to say. Amen. To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Let the church say amen. Amen.